Okay, so today we are going to discuss reactions of reactions of monosaccharide. Okay, now when we are talking about reactions of monosaccharide, you must immediately understand that we are actually talking about a processed version of aldehyde or ketone. That means we are actually talking about reactions which are actually given positive by aldehydes or ketones. But there is an important difference. The important difference is this, that all the reactions which are given by aldehyde and ketones, all the reactions which are given by aldehydes and ketones are not given by monosaccharides. Why? The reason is simple, because it's a polyhydroxy derivative. That means it has got many secondary alcohol groups. Okay. Now, when we are talking about the reactions of monosaccharides, you must understand that there are basically two types of reactions. Okay. And their mechanisms are completely different. Now listen, whenever we are talking about reactions of monosaccharide, there are two types of reactions. In the first place, or in the first type of reaction, this type of reaction, actually in the first reaction, you must understand that these reactions are set of reactions which deals with the side chains of monosaccharide. What are side chains? Let us take an example of glucose. Suppose this is our very own glucose. Okay, this was the structure, right? Okay, now listen, this was the structure of glucose. Now you must understand that these are the side chains. These are the side chains. Now it's very important for you now, you people, for you to understand now, that is, these side chains, in case of the first type of reaction, these side chains will be affected. Okay, that means either these side chains will undergo modification, or these side chains will go up and down. That means there are two types of reaction. That is, in the first reaction, these side chains will undergo modification. Okay, that is, first type is side chains undergo what? Undergo modifications, or second is these side chains go up and down. Clear? These side chains go up and down. Now listen, we'll talk about this in detail, but can you name any reaction in which side chains undergo modifications? You will be asked several questions from this reaction. And the reaction in which side chains undergo modifications is called epimerization. This reaction results in epimer formation. This reaction results in epimer formation. And do you know any reaction in which these side chains go up and down? Do you know any reactions in which these side chains go up and down? You don't know anything about? Okay, so you people all have passed your board exams, right? Then you must know one thing, that there was something, conversion from glucose to fructose, right? This type of reaction in which you can convert glucose to fructose, that means what? In glucose, the primary functional group is present in the first carbon, or the primary functional group constitutes the first carbon. And you must understand that in fructose, the primary functional group is in the
second.
That means what? This particular side chain has gone up, right? That's the thing. That's the mechanism. What is the name of this mechanism? Enediol formation. This is enediol formation, okay. That means probably, okay, we'll talk about this. Now, important point you need to understand is this, that we are going to take a big tour with respect to reactions of monosaccharide, but you must understand this thing as well, that whenever we are talking about reactions of monosaccharide, it's not only about, you know, side chain reactions. Okay, it's not only about side chain reactions. There are reactions in which the aldehyde group is also affected and the terminal OH group is also affected. Okay, we'll talk about them later. Why? Because the reactions in which the aldehyde group is affected or keto group is affected is called reduction or oxidation of monosaccharides. Okay, and why these are important? Because, you know, we'll talk about them later, because there are certain, you know, tests, biochemical tests, using which we can detect glucose or fructose. These tests are actually, you know, the product of these reactions. Clear? Specifically, this enediol formation. We'll talk about that. So, let us divide the reactions of monosaccharide based on whether the side chain is getting affected or the functional group is getting affected, right? That means if you divide this, then you must understand that there are two types of reactions. Reactions in which side chains are affected. Okay, clear? Side chains are affected. And there are reactions in which primary functional groups are affected. Clear? Okay. Now, a very important point you must understand is this. When we will be talking about these reactions, there are two types, right? Okay. That is, orientation of side chain is what? Changed? Reaction 1. Reaction type 1. Orientation of side chain is changed. Number 2, reaction type 2 primary functional group moves up or down. These are the, you know, reaction types under first reaction. Okay. So, we'll first talk about this. But before we proceed to the basic mechanism, now listen. Actually, this class is not only for biology students, it is also for chemistry students. Why? Because these reactions are not only important for you people, but the outcomes are very much important for you as well, because in some days you will be performing in the lab the tests to detect glucose, fructose or galactose. Before that, you must know the biochemical basis or chemical basis of these tests. Otherwise, it will be just a practical class for you. You won't understand anything. Clear? Now listen. If I tell you that there is a similarity between reaction type 1 and reaction type 2, what will be the similarity? If I tell you that there is a similarity between in reaction type 1 and reaction type 2, what is the similarity? What is the similarity? Listen, the similarity between reaction type 1 and reaction type 2 is both are base catalyzed reaction. Both are base catalyzed reaction. That means OH minus will be the primary mediator. OH minus will be the primary mediator. That means reaction type 1, orientation of side chain is changed. That is, what is the most important example of this type of reaction? Epimerization. That is, epimerization occurs in presence of a base, or enediol formation. This is enediol formation, right? Enediol formation occurs in presence of a base. Clear? This is the basic thing you need to know. Okay. Now, very important points are right now there, that what is the what are the dissimilarities between epimerization and enediol formation? Okay. Don't worry. When we'll be talking about in details the epimerization reaction mechanism and enediol formation reaction mechanism, you will understand. But for your own benefit, I am telling you, in epimerization reaction, only one mole of OH minus is required. Okay, there is only one OH minus is required. But here, enediol formation, two OH minus at different steps are required. Okay, so this is the, you know, take home message like thing. But now, at first, we'll talk about epimerization. Okay, then we will try to solve some basic. Then we'll try to know the structure of basic epimers. Okay. Now, when we are talking about base catalyzed reaction, you must understand that every monosaccharide have two forms, right? That is open chain form, right, which is called Fischer projection now, or closed Haworth projection. Now, you must understand this basic thing, that base catalyzed reaction, that is epimerization or enediol formation, these type of reactions are specifically performed by open chain form. And this open chain form is partially present in every glucose or any monosaccharide solution. You must understand this. That means a very low amount or low percentage of carbohydrate never undergoes Haworth projection or never forms Haworth projection. And these forms actually gives a positive test for base catalyzed reaction. Okay. Now we'll talk about the base catalyzed reaction, that is epimerization first. Now, so we will now talk about epimerization, which is also known by the name of formation of epimers. Okay, now listen. If you really want to know epimerization, you must understand that suppose we are taking an example of glucose. Suppose we are taking an example of glucose, okay? So, this is your glucose, right? This is your glucose. Now, it's very important point for you people to understand that we are right now discussing that how C2 epimer of glucose is produced, that is mannose. C2 epimer of glucose is what? Mannose. What is protose? And C4 epimer of glucose is called galactose. That means if the same reaction occurs at C4 position, then it is galactose. Now listen, what is epimerization? We have already discussed that there are certain types of reaction in which orientation of OH groups are changed, around a particular carbon. One of the best example is epimerization. What is that? Now listen. Suppose this is your glucose. Okay. Now, this is what? Epimerization is a what? Base catalyzed reaction. That means what? That means it will be mediated by OH minus. That means an OH minus will at first attack any group. Now listen with all your attention. Suppose this OH minus attacks this H, then this carbon here goes to, then these electrons goes to this carbon at C2 position. Why? Because we are trying to create a C2 polymer. Now listen. Now after this OH minus attack, what will be the situation in this particular carbon? Now listen, if you remember chemistry class of your 11 and 12, you will understand that OH minus is what? A nucleophile or an electrophile? It is a nucleophile. Why? No, listen. It is called a nucleophile, right? Nucleophile. Why? That means this is having a negative charge. That's why, in an atom, nucleus is positively charged and electrons are negatively charged. It's a nucleophile. That means it is nucleus lover. That means nucleophiles are always what? Negatively charged. Right? How will you remember? It's very simple. Nucleophile starts with N. Negativity also starts with N. Simple. Okay? Now listen. What are nucleophiles and electrophiles? These are? Listen. In organic chemistry, there are two parts of a reaction. Number one. That means, suppose if you want to perform an organic chemistry reaction, you need two things. First, substrate and reagent. Nucleophile, electrophiles, these are reagents. And there is a rule in chemistry that in organic chemistry, the substrate concentration should be high and reagent concentration should be low, which is called law of limiting reagent. Clear? Now, following all the law of limiting reagent, why we need low reagent concentration? Why we need low reagent concentration and high substrate concentration? Because at the end of the reaction, reagent may or may not change, but substrate changes. That means some leftover reagents are always there. Why? Now listen, we'll discuss in great details. That means what I am saying is, reagents, we require reagents at low concentration. We require reagents at low concentration, right? Now listen, if we require low concentration of OH minus, that then you must say that suppose one reagent reacts with one glucose, then another glucose requires another OH minus, right? That means what I am saying is you need low reagent concentration and high substrate concentration. But according to your own concept, so now you must understand that what I am saying is you need lower concentration of reagent and higher concentration of substrate. But according to your concept of organic chemistry, no, which is funny, that is, we need one substrate and one reagent, right? Now listen, if I tell you that at the end of this reaction, you will get another OH minus, that means this is very shocking. Why? Because this is a reagent. And according to the concept of substrate, this is a substrate. That means you are giving lesser amount of OH minus or base in the particular, reaction beaker, okay, and you are giving more amount of glucose. But my question is this: why we require lesser amount of OH minus? Why there is a concept of limiting reagent? If you give equal amount of substrate and equal amount of reagent, then probably the speed of the reaction will be low. According to what? Law of kinetics of chemical equilibrium. Okay, according to the law of chemical kinetics, this will be lower. How can we take the reaction forward? Simple. By lowering the reagent concentration. But why I am saying this? Because reagents, actually, what they do is, they get involved in a particular reaction, then they come out totally unchanged and they react again. That means their concentration in most cases, their concentration remains almost constant. How? We are talking about that. Now listen. Now, before we proceed, you must understand what we are going to achieve. Okay? We are going to achieve an epimer. That is, we are going to achieve a simple epimerization reaction. What is an epimerization reaction? Epimerization reaction is a stereochemical shift around a particular carbon. Okay? What is stereochemical shift? Suppose this OH group is present here at the right hand side. At the end of this reaction, this OH group will be present at the left hand side. And this H will be present here. That means what we are trying to do is, we are actually trying to convert this OH into H and this H into OH. Okay? Clear? That is our motto. Okay? That is our motto. How we are going to achieve it? By adding base. Simple. Okay? Now listen. What this base is doing, listen. Actually, this base is interacting with this H. Okay? Now listen. At first, what it will do is, this base will take out this hydrogen. This base will take out this hydrogen. Okay? It is taking out this hydrogen. That means, now listen, when you are trying to draw the epimerization steps, you must always understand all the reactions are reversible. Okay, all the reactions are reversible. That means, now listen, suppose this is your glucose molecule after there is an attack of OH minus. Okay. Now, if this OH minus has taken out H plus, that means this H plus and this OH minus will now react to give out what? Water. Right? Now listen with all your attention. It's very important for you people to understand. You know, there is a disturbance in this carbon. Why? What is the name of this species which has been produced? Yes, what?
Carbon.
What?
Carbon.
Carbon? I've never heard anything like carbon. Okay, he's a stupid person who is saying that this is a chiral carbon. Chiral carbon is a carbon which is having four valences. It doesn't have any four valences. What is the name of this carbon, or what is the name of this species at least? Okay, what you are saying is it's a nucleophile. But it's a dangerous thing. No. He is saying that this is a nucleophile. Okay, now listen. A substrate cannot give birth to a reagent always. Listen with all your attention. A substrate cannot give birth to a reagent. This is a substrate on which the reagent has already taken its action. This is a substrate. But on the body of the substrate, there is a species. Have you never heard of something like carbocations? Have you never heard something called carbanions? You know, there are carbocations, right? Carbo means what? Carbon. Cations means what? Positive. That means if in a substrate, listen with all your attention, if in a substrate, there is a carbon and that carbon possesses a positive charge in the intermediate step, which is called? Okay, these are all idiots. Which is called, I love teaching organic chemistry, which is called rate determining step, RDS. In the RDS only these things all occur in a substrate. Clear? Now listen. What is a carbocation? If in a substrate there is a RDS going on, and in that particular substrate carbon is having a plus charge, then it is carbocation. Carbo means carbon, cation, you know. Now listen, in this reaction what has happened? Yes, it has led to the formation of a carbanion. What is carbanion? carbon anion, that means having a negative charge, that is it is called carbon anion. Why they are called species, you know? Because they are not what? Reagent, they are substrate. Substrate will always have species, substrate will always give rise to species. Yes, that's true thing. Now listen, so this, there is a confusion here. Why, you know? Listen with all your attention. So due to the attacking of this particular OH minus, due to the attacking of this particular OH minus or base, there is a carbocation, carbanion formation within the substrate itself, right? But there is another thing, you know, very much dangerous here. What, you know? This carbon, the second carbon, has lost its chirality. This carbon has lost its chirality. Why? Because it is now having sp2 hybridization. Chirality occurs when there is sp3 hybridization. So it has lost its chirality. It is no longer asymmetric. It is no longer asymmetric. Clear? It is no longer asymmetric. What is asymmetric carbon? We'll talk about that. Okay? You people should know what are asymmetric carbons? Fomic. What are asymmetric carbons? Subhangar. What is chiral carbon? Chiral carbon equals asymmetric carbon. These two terms are same. Now you tell me, what is chiral carbon? Any carbon having four valences. Any carbon having four valences. That means this carbon is in sp3 hybridization state and having four different groups. Right? Every book says that. But probably you don't know how. Suppose if I tell you that this carbon here is chiral carbon, will you believe me? Yes, obviously you should believe me. Why? Because this carbon is having four groups, four different groups. Why? This is one of the, you know what? This is one of the valency of this carbon. This is another valency. Now listen. This, and this. These are the four valencies this carbon is having, right? Look at the four groups the carbon is dealing with. All these four groups are different. That's why this is a chiral carbon. Now look at this carbon. It is having this, and this. This carbon is also having four different groups, sir. Four different groups. Look at this carbon. This total, this, and this. This carbon is also chiral, but this carbon is not chiral. The ultimate carbon is never chiral. Why? Because it has got two hydrogen atoms. That means ABB, this is not a chiral carbon then. And chiral carbons have the ability to rotate a plane polarized light. We'll talk about that later, okay? When we will be specifically talking about physics lectures, okay? Quantum mechanics. Clear? These carbons have special ability to rotate electromagnetic vector as well as, sorry, electric vector as well as magnetic vector of a light. Light has two vectors, electric vector and magnetic vector. These carbons have special ability because of their orientation to actually rotate every possible vector of light. That's why they are called what? Chiral carbons. Or what? Optically active carbons. Clear? Why they are optically active carbon? Because they are rotating the plane polarized light. They are rotating, or they are shifting the pathway of light. Clear? Now we are shifting from the discussion. We will talk about these things later. We will have a very big, you know, class on optical isomerism of carbohydrates. Don't worry. But right now we must discuss this very detail. Now I'm drawing this stuff again. Not stuff. It reminds you of something else. Why are you laughing? Now listen. Suppose this is your carbanion. Right? This is your carbanion. Okay. Here is your very own glucose having this disrupted carbon. Okay, now listen. Now what will happen is, it's very important for you people to understand here is, the most important thing that will happen now is, this carbon, you know, two carbons two carbons, one having negative charge, another is in sp2 hybridization, that will always lead to what? Always lead to, in most of the cases, always lead to, that means this carbon will now go here and this will now, right? Now listen, there was a chance, you know, now listen, for a short period of time, now listen with all your attention, for a short period of time this actually occurs, this actually happens. That means for a short period of time this single bond becomes a double bond. How can you say that there is a presence of double bond? Read the NMR data, you will understand. These things, that whether sigma bond or pi and sigma bonds are present, these things are read by NMR. Read the NMR data, you will understand that there was a double bond. But there is an important difference between this configuration and this configuration. Why you know? Because listen, important point you need to understand is this, that this is your what? Pi bond. This is pi and sigma. Now listen with all your attention. This carbon is having two pi bonds and three sigma bonds, right? That means this carbon is still in what? Still in sp2, because in hybridization we only count what? Exactly, sigma bonds. There are 1, 2, 3, three sigma bonds, sp2. But there are two pi bonds will fight so that one pi bond gets out. But listen, in most of the cases what happens is this pi bond actually moves to the more negatively charged or more electronegative atom, that is oxygen, and it will stay there. Now this oxygen will now again return this, you know, pi electron cloud, and this will again come to the carbon. But this won't happen in case of carbohydrates. This won't happen in epimerization reaction. Why? Because, now listen, can you name any reaction which is not taking in water? There is probably no reaction which is not taking in any media, right? Whether it is water, whether it is anything else, in chemistry there must be some media in which the reaction is occurring, right? Now listen, can you dissolve carbohydrate in kerosene or any organic media? Or in can you do this? That means you need a polar solvent. You need a polar solvent. The best polar solvent in the world is water. Now listen, there is the problem, that is water will intervene here. That's the problem. Water intervenes. Why water intervenes? Then you probably don't know that there are some, you know, unique reactions in organic chemistry which will actually stop physically if you don't pour water to them. You don't know this. Probably, okay. No, we have a separate video on this, okay. Water hydrolysis. Now listen, the point you need to understand is this, that this pi bond is now actually fighting that which one will go to which carbon. Now listen with all your attention. The chance that this pi bond, now listen, there are two pi bonds here and here, right? The chance that this pi bond will come back to carbon is less. Why?
Because of this water.
No. Why? Why do you think? Why? Why? Why?
Oxygen is more electronegativity than carbon.
Partially right. Now listen, let me explain. Listen, these two carbons having what? Similar electronegativities, right? These two carbons have similar electronegativities, but there is a marked difference in electronegativity between carbon and oxygen. That means the possibility of coming this pi electron to this carbon is really less. But if you tell these pi electrons that there are some species waiting for you, there are some species, or specifically H+, which is coming from this water, which are actually waiting for you, and they need your electrons, they will jump. Why? Because these pi electrons want to move to carbon or this oxygen, but they don't have any what? they don't have any option. Why you know? Because you know that inductive effect works via sigma bonds. They cannot jump. So there is a possibility that this pi electron will be taken up by H plus provided by water media. Now listen, in some reactions this may occur that, now listen, these two electrons are now being passed to H plus, which is provided by water. Then what will happen? Now listen with all your attention. It's now a fair luck, okay, of the carbohydrate. Now listen what will happen. This H plus needs how many electrons? Two. There are no electrons in the H plus. That's why it is called a proton, right? Because only one proton is left. For the completion of its duplet structure, there is hydrogen needs two electrons, right? And these two electrons are provided by these pi bonds, right? That means there is an establishment of bond between this carbon and this hydrogen now. Why between this carbon and this hydrogen? Why not between this carbon and this hydrogen? Because these electrons were actually provided by this carbon. Clear? These electrons were actually provided by this carbon. Clear? That means there is a what? Establishment of what? Sigma bond between this hydrogen and this carbon. That means what? That means you have got back your H. You have got back your H. Now listen, I was telling what? There is something called law of limiting reagent. That means you must get back your OH minus. You have got your OH minus here, sir, from water. That's why you don't need what? Large quantity of or extra quantity of OH or reagent. That means the law of limiting reagent actually matters. Why you know? Listen, don't write. These are stupid things you are learning, okay? You must have read this in your, you know, younger classes. Okay, now listen. First thing you must understand, if you pour more amount of what? OH minus, then the reaction will move forward. Then the reaction will be backward. Why? Because there is many OH minus, but not much what? Carbohydrates. That means what? The reaction velocity will go down. Clear? Okay. So we will get a carbohydrate. Now listen with all your attention. We'll get a carbohydrate like this. Okay. Now, why am I not drawing this particular carbon? Are you surprised, sir? Are you surprised by the organic chemistry class? You need it here. Why I am not drawing this carbon here? Because there is a probability that this hydrogen will attack from behind and there will be hydrogen here. But there is also a probability that this hydrogen will attack from here and there will be a carbon hydrogen bonding here and this OH will have to move here. That means what you are getting here is a what? Transition in OH bond or orientation of OH and H bond. This is called epimerization. And this is what? This is nothing but a transformed glucose. But this is actually glucose molecule. But it is just what? It is actually glucose molecule having a shift in CH-OH bonding in the C2 position. These types of molecules are called epimers, and this is a mannose. Mannose is nothing but this is what? D mannose. Why? Because OH is present on the right side. D mannose. And what I was saying is mannose is a C2 epimer. Okay. So now we'll be discussing the structure of galactose. Okay. Galactose is a C4 epimer of glucose. It's a C4 epimer of glucose, okay? So, suppose this is your glucose. Suppose this is your glucose. Now, this is carbon number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? Now, if you want to convert this into a C4 epimer, then you will have to turn this, right? So, this is your C4 epimer, that is galactose, okay? So, what is the C2 epimer of glucose? Mannose. And C4 epimer of glucose is galactose, okay? Now, you need to understand another thing. So, this is your galactose, this is D-galactose, right? D-galactose, right? Now, we will talk about those reactions. Now, we will talk about those reactions in which you can actually change the position of CHOH group, or you can think it like this, that you can actually change the position of this keto group. Now, we will talk about those reactions in which you can actually change the position of keto groups. Now, you must understand, suppose if I want to change the position of a keto group of aldehyde, that means what? I am trying to bring this down. Because I cannot take it up, there is no carbons here. That means if I want to bring it down, then I am creating accidentally what? Aldehydes or ketones? I am creating ketones. You people are, you know, horrible with respect to organic chemistry. These are ketones. And just instead of this R, this is aldehyde, right? This is aldehyde. This is the H, this is the oxygen, and this is your R group. But if I bring this down here, if I just change it here, if I bring this down here, then it is the
fructose.
This is what? This is fructose. That means this is one R, this is another R. That means it is becoming a ketone. Okay? That means in the next reaction, we will actually pull the aldehyde group down. And we will create fructose from glucose. Okay, this type of reaction is called Enediol formation or Enediol reaction. Okay, in this type of reaction, the intermediate product which is formed is called Enediol, and it is very much important for you people to understand what is Enediol, because Enediol is a very good reducing agent. Okay, it's a reducing agent, and the reducing property of Enediols forms the basis of identification tests of glucose and fructose, like Benedict. Okay, Benedict test. Okay. Now, we will talk about the reaction mechanism of Enediol formation, right? Now, do you know what is Enediol? We'll talk about this in details. You know what is Enediol? Now listen. Again, Enediol formation is nothing but another what? Base catalyzed reaction. That means again you will need an
OH-
for the initiation of reaction, right? Now, what you will have to do here is, again, now listen. You will have to specifically attack the second carbon here. Again, that is clear. Now, what is happening is, what is happening here is this H plus will come out. And this H plus will now react with what? OH minus. They will form water and they will come out, right? Now listen with all your attention. Now this electron will go towards the carbon. Again, formation of carbon anion will occur, right? Now listen with all your attention what is happening now. It's very important. Earlier when we were talking about, you know, epimerization reaction, what we were doing is actually we were actually attacking this carbon with an H plus from water, and then epimerization occurred, right? But here what we will do is we'll take the H plus from water, no doubt, but instead of attacking this H plus here, this H plus will now attack here. Clear? This H plus will now attack here. That is, instead of attacking this carb anion center, this H plus will now attack the O minus center present in the first carbon. That means instantaneously there will be a production of OH group here. Instantaneously there will be a production of OH group. Now listen, this carbon is now having a permanent double bond. That means the important structure here is, right? Clear? This is the structure. Now listen with all your attention possible. So there will be another OH, right? This OH is from this. Now listen, this is a very important, you know, compound. Why? Because this compound contains carbon-carbon double bond, which is carbon-carbon double bond means what? How to do a nomenclature of carbon-carbon double bond or alkenes in, and it is having two alcohol group, that means diol. That's why this compound is now known as enediol. Okay, this is enediol. Why? Because in, the first thing stands for, the first name stands for the carbon-carbon double bond, sp2 hybridized carbons, and diol stands for the secondary
two OH
groups attached to two carbon-carbon double bonds. Carbons which are double bonds. Sorry, yes. Okay. Now listen with all your attention. The next step will be the more critical one. Why? Now listen with all your attention. Suppose if I tell you that this is very important, you know, in most of your biochemistry books, if you can check that enediol formation, this enediol is applied, you know, for conversion of and it has got blue color, and this blue color is actually the confirmatory test for, you know, many things. Actually not blue color, you will have to heat it and all these things. We'll talk about the detection of carbohydrates later, but this is the basis. Why? Because this enediol formation is very important for the detection of carbohydrates, because enediol formation or enediol is given only by carbohydrates. And when this enediol reacts with any, you know, copper ions or any other ions, it will give its characteristic color. Now that means what? It is giving its own electrons. That means it is what? Reducing in nature. So enediol actually have reducing nature, okay? But we are actually not interested in this right now, because this reducing nature of enediols, we'll talk about this reducing nature of enediols later when we will be talking about tests of carbohydrates. There are many tests of carbohydrates, like disaccharides don't give this type of tests, monosaccharide gives only this type of test. There are many, you know, distinguishing characters. We'll talk about these things later, but right now we are not at all interested. Right now we are interested in shifting this keto group from carbon number 1 position to carbon number 2 position. Have we established it? No. Now, what we will have to do is here, we will have to take another OH minus. Okay? Now listen, if I tell you that there is no need of taking OH minus from outside, why? Yes, because there was water and water has been split into H plus and OH minus, and this OH minus will come here, and this OH minus will attack this OH group, and this will take, now listen with all your attention, this will take the H group of OH, and H plus OH is H2O. It's so simple. That means we are successfully converting listen, this is a transition state. Now we are successfully converting. We are on the verge of successfully converting this carbon-carbon double bond into a carbon-carbon single bond. But for that, what we need? We need another sigma bond. Why you know? Because if this double bond comes here, then this carbon will have one less valency. That means we should have another valency. And you know how to fill valencies? With hydrogen. Now listen, from where does this hydrogen comes? Right? The most important question. Now listen with all your attention. This hydrogen actually comes from water. Wow, listen, this pi electron which is on the verge of getting out will attack another water molecule, and water will be split into H plus and OH minus. And when this pi electron is attacking this water, H plus will take up the pi electron and will be added here. Now, why do you think this carbon is taking this hydrogen? Because the pi electron from this carbon actually attacked this H plus. And now listen, you are now left with what? OH minus? Listen again, law of limiting reagent. OH minus is again there, so that it can act again. Okay. Now, what you are left with? You are now left with this structure. See, H2OH, that is, if I draw like this, CH2OH, C double bond O, CH2OH, okay? Okay? So this is the, you know, ultimate structure of what? Fructose. So we have successfully converted glucose into fructose. Okay, one of the basic conversion you had to do in your younger classes. Okay.